Brooklyn Butch here, and this is a brand new radio show. What's it about? Anything at all. What's the difference? Come on, people. Daydreams? That could be. Brooklyn? Why not? I come from there. Gambling? I've been a professional gambler just about all my life. Action bowling? Do you know what that is? That's bowling head-to-head, mano-to-mano. Put the money up and let's see who can win. I love that. But in general, anything at all. You know, one thing I'm going to tell you right up front, I'm not great at doing interviews. Really, I don't know why. It just doesn't come natural to me. But I'm going to let people talk mainly. I'm not going to interview them when they come on the show. We'll have a little back and forth, of course, but I'm just going to let them go. I'm going to let them bloviate. I heard that word someplace. Was that Rush Limbaugh? I don't even know. But anyway, yeah. Brooklyn is where I was born and raised. It started off in Bay Ridge, 1944. Fifth Avenue between Ovington and 72nd Street. Lived above a carpet store. Right next to Narvin's Bakery. I could wake up every morning. I could smell it, the fragrance of those great donuts, those great cheese danishes, the bread, the whole bit, just plain loved it. And let me tell you something. Living there back then, you know, I hit the streets. It's like I graduated from being in the house to a regular street kid, let's say at 6 years old, not bad, right? And there was everything there. I mean, I'll tell you, up and down, you didn't need a car. Not that I could drive at 6 years old, but I did have, I guess they call it a soapbox racer or something like that. These fantastic things that we built with a 2x4. Then we'd take, I think it was an American Flyer skate or something like that, that we would get from Shift Brothers. Actually, they threw away certain ones for whatever reason, I don't know. But you take one skate, you pull it apart, very easy to do. You put the front wheels at the beginning of the 2x4, the back wheels at the back of the 2x4. You nailed it in, you went down to the fruit store, on 5th between 69th and Ovington. You got yourself a wooden box that they shipped grapefruits in, whatever it might have been. You nail that to the front of the 2x4. You add some handles to that, you know, that's just some sticks, and you're ready to go. Let me tell you something. This thing here could really move. This was your ride. And we had everything there, though. I mean, I'm telling you, right down there on 69th Street, the things that were of interest to me anyway. Let's not go through all the boring stuff. The Lowe's Alpine Theater. Oh, let me tell you, it was a palace back then, one of the biggest of its kind. I think when Lowe's built it, as a matter of fact, it might have been the biggest one-floor movie theater in the country or something. Right across the street, a fantastic ice cream parlor. Down the block, a pizza place, a Dairy Queen. Down there on Ovington, we had the bowling alley. We had the pool room. Now, of course, at 6, 7 years old, I wasn't old enough to go in there. But my father liked his beer. Oh, yeah. The man would work 2-3 jobs, and he still had plenty of time somehow to hit the bars because he could stay there and drink all night and go right back to work the next day and then go to his second job. At that time, the first job was the bank, yeah, on 75th and 5th, the Brooklyn Savings Bank. His main part-time job, I believe, was in Paul's Ice Cream Parlor, and then he worked as a bartender at Ovington. He worked as a bartender over on 72nd Street on the corner of 5th Avenue, a few different spots. But he would bring me in there, sit me on his knee, give me what they call a Shirley Temple. He would have his beer, and back in those days, the bars were really like a family thing. Not that my father brought the family in and hung out with it, never brought my mother in. Well, I guess she was in there, but in general, no. But he had his buddies. They would drink, they would gamble together, play little cards at the bar, so on and so forth. And this was my introduction, and it stayed in my blood my whole life. But let me tell you, fantastic, fantastic place to grow up. I was best of friends with Peter Keene. He lived over on 72nd and 5th Avenue, right in the corner, above the drugstore. Big building. He was up, I believe, on the third floor. And we just did everything together. The difference with me and Peter was, though, well, he was about a year older than me. Tough kid. Wouldn't mess with Peter, but you know, everything had to do with age. Not everything, but most things. And for my age, a year younger, I was a tough kid, too. Yeah. Got to a point after I did my scuffles with a different Peter Thomas, who lived right next to the candy store. Yeah, we had a candy store on the block. We had all kinds of stuff. Let me tell you, Jewish deli, a grocery store, just fantastic, fantastic place to live. But I got into a fight with Peter Thomas, I think, at five years old. My mother used to send me down to the newsstand, the grocery store, to get her cigarettes. But Peter Thomas was out, who lived right next to it. He wouldn't let me pass his house. And my mother caught me backing down one day, and she told me, "You go over and fight him. You don't take that from him." And we had a fight, and I won at such a young age. And that opened up a whole new world to me. But we're going to get back into this. I started bowling at about 10 years old. Now, back then, in those days, you weren't even allowed into a bowling alley or a pool room until you were 16 years old. But the bar at Ovington also had the bowling alley right there on the ground floor. It had the luncheonette, had more bowling downstairs and a pool room upstairs. And one day my father asked me if I wanted to bowl. I mean, this was amazing. You're not even allowed in there at 10. But I went in there and I bowled the game. They had pin boys at the time, and I just got instantly hooked. It took me about a year to break 100. But what happened was I was able to go in there any day at all, every day in practice. And my father would set it up with the owner, Eddie, to just let me go in and bowl. And then he would square with him at the end of the week. He probably even got a discount. I think games at that time were probably a quarter of games. And I started getting better and better and better. When I was about 13 years old, I got introduced to action bowling. And let me tell you a quick story how it happened. By this time, I was subbing for my father in a bowling league most of the time, because he really enjoyed just sitting in the bar more than actually bowling. But I really was getting very good. I was already bowling about a 177 average, and it was right around second or third high average in the league. And we were going up against the number one team. This was position night, championship night, whatever you call it. And in order for us to take the championship, we had to win all three games. And the best bowler in the league was on that team, Jimmy Nolan, who also was pin boy or in charge of the pin boys, whatever it might be, a lefty with a big hook like I never saw before, fantastic bowler. I mean, there's nobody, and I mean nobody, that could come into Ovington and bowl Jimmy for money. He would just eat them up, spit them out, and destroy them. And he was good elsewhere, too. It wasn't just at Ovington. So anyway, we take the three games, and we win the league. And I shot very good that night. Somehow Jimmy and my father got into a little argument. I don't know what it was about. He just said that we were lucky. My father, bum, bum, bum. The whole bit, whatever. But anyway, my father does something that I just couldn't believe. He tells Jimmy, "Put up your money. My son will bowl you." But my father was smart enough to know, not at Ovington. Even though this was my home alley, you don't beat Jimmy Nolan at Ovington. So he picks a brand new bowling alley up on 88th Street, Leemark. I was never there before. We go up there. I was never in a place like this. Big, beautiful, brand new. We get up there, and we're going to bowl for $50, three games total wood. Let me tell you something. $50 was a lot of money, because this is what a man would make working full-time and pay his bills for the week with. So $50 was not something to sneeze at. We get up, and let me tell you, I'm shaking. My legs are shaking. My toes are shaking. My nose is shaking. My fingers are shaking. That's how nervous I was. And the first ball I throw goes off my ankle. And somehow it ends up being a strike. And Jimmy Nolan had opened up his first frame. And this kind of took the pressure off me. Well, anyway, I go on to bowl in three games like I have never bowled in my life. I mean, I'm talking 277 the first game, come back with a 260-something the second game, and about a 238 the third game. Needless to say, I win the match. And my father gives me that 50 plus 50 or 100 more, whatever it was from the league, and all in singles. He gives me this the next day. And I feel like the richest guy in the world. I end up going to another place I was never in before, Evan & Wen Bowl, another fairly new place that just opened up. And I walk in there with my bowling ball and bag in my hand and a pocket full of money. And I felt like I was going to take over the world. And that is how I got involved with Action Bowling. And there's going to be so many more stories about it, but let's not jump on any one thing. This is a brand new show. Let's talk about daydreams. Not only am I a big daydreamer, but you ready for this? I think they're real. No. Butch believes daydreams are just as real as what we call our reality life or real life, whatever it might be. I kind of have this feeling that you can have dual existence at one time, different time zones, different things happening within the same space, that it's all in your mind. And if you create it, it's real. I mean, I don't care if it's the type of dream when you go to night, you start snoring, or whatever it might be, or you sit in some place in the day and your mind starts to wander, and we call this a daydream. Well, we're going to go in, not right now either, the reality of the daydreams that I've had, especially back when I owned the cab in Brooklyn. It's just totally unbelievable, but they're absolutely real. And, okay, let's talk a little bit more about the show in general. Well, I'm in Atlantic City now for the last 10 years, actually. Brooklyn Butch, a.k.a. A.C. Butch. If you check me out on the internet, I'm all over the internet. A.C. Butch, Atlantic City Butch, but Brooklyn, that's the original. And I do a lot of blogging in a lot of Facebook groups. And the Brooklyn groups are the ones that I enjoy the most, going back to Bay Ridge and Sheepshead Bay and Bensonhurst. I lived in all of these places, East Flatbush, Mapleton, whatever you want to call it. Butch was there, lived there at different times of his life, had businesses. I love business. I love being what we'll call an entrepreneur. Yeah, Brooklyn Butch, a business entrepreneur. Love it. This is the one thing, actually, that turns me on the most, is being creative, building something. Not saying I love to work it. I love to create it. I love to build it. And then let somebody else take over one way or another, whether it be sell it to them or turn it over to them and stay in the background. I'm not going to get too long-winded. There's just so much we got to save some for later. So I'm going to just cut it off right now.
Out on the Kokomo. The night was young and the moon was gold, so we both decided to take a stroll. Can you imagine the way I felt? I couldn't unfasten a safety belt. Riding along in my calaboose, still trying to get her belt loose. All the way home I held a grudge.
safety belt that wouldn't budge. Cruising and playing the radio with no particular place to go.